one.
Thank you.
the silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. I know you feel like dying, but I promise you we take the world to its feet and move mountains. We take the world to its feet and for that we got each other, yeah, yeah. And for that we got each other, yes. We will rise, we will rise, and we will rise, oh. We will rise, and rise up, rise like the day I rise up. Yeah. In spite of my head, I will rise a thousand times again. Thank you.
Amen. As we begin our proceedings, may I ask everyone to stand for the marching on of the portrait. Gentlemen, you may have your seats. Minister of Trinidad and Tobago and first Prime Minister, Dr. Eric Eustace Williams. This morning, I recognize Mr. Vidal, Chairman of the Eric Williams Memorial Committee, members of the Diplomatic Corps, His Excellency Alvaro Sanchez Cordero, Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, Her Excellency Bengu Vigit Gudin, Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Republic of Turkey, Her Excellency Sylvia Edith Miller Palmer, Ambassador of the Republic of Panama, I recognize my own Commandant, Lieutenant Colonel Reynold York, Acting Commandant of the Trinidad and Tobago Cadet Force, former Minister and the current Ms. Joan Yu Williams, former Minister of Government, members of clergy, distinguished and honorable awardees, honorable guests, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, members of the Trinidad and Tobago Cadet Force, the Girl Guides, and the Scouts, good morning. As we begin this morning, we will begin with some prayers from members of the clergy, and we start with Pastor Clive Dutton, representing the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Pastor Dutton. I may have missed it on the program. Please may I ask you to stand for the playing of the national anthem.
Chronicles 7 verse 14. God is replying to Solomon, who asked for forgiveness in case and when the people should sin. God's reply, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Shall we pray? Loving Father, we are thankful, O God, that Brother Vidal and the Eric Williams Memorial Committee could have found it deep within their hearts to have an attitude of gratitude for full chief minister and premier and then prime minister for his outstanding work, for the legacy that he left for all of us. O God, we pray for your divine power. We are going through a very difficult time. We have problems, O God, with our dear teenagers and young adults who are wrapped up in the area of crime and violence. But we pray for them, loving God. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our dear Prime Minister, Dr. Rowley, for the President, President Paula Mae Weeks, and the Leader of the Opposition, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa. We pray for all those in business, all those in the clergy. We pray, O God, that we will be unselfish, noble, decent, and compassionate, and recognize that your love is unconditional. Because if we have your love in our hearts, we will assist, we'll reach out to those who are in need, we will care for the underprivileged. Loving God, We pray today that the Hindus would love the Muslims would love the Catholics would love the Baptists will love the Adventists. We pray, O God, that we will all look out for each other and recall that you are the great God and you love us unconditionally. And one day very soon you shall appear in the clouds of glory. We'll have no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more pain. This be your prayer in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And amen.
And now representing the Archbishop of the Catholic Church, we have M. D. Chatur.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I bring you greetings and blessings from His Grace the Archbishop. And as we celebrate, commemorate today in the Christian faith, the Feast of the Holy Trinity, we call down on our gathering and on our nation the blessings, the power, and the love of the Holy Trinity. In the Old Testament, in the Book of Wisdom, chapter 3, I quote, "The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace." As we reflect on these words and the words just said by my brother in faith, Brother Dutton, we take the opportunity to recall the lives and times of our nation's first Chief Minister, Premier and Prime Minister, and Father of the Nation, the late Dr. Eric William. As we remember him, we pray, Lord of all creation, in the many ways the old order has passed away, but we are confident that in your bounteous mercy, you have welcomed Dr. Williams into your heavenly realm. We pray,
representing the Baptist faith, Bishop Patrick Roberts.
To Brother Vidal, bless God, His Worship. And with the key to San Fernando, Auntie Sister June, all the clergy, all who are present, and those even who are viewing, as we continue in prayer, the writer pen, what a friend we have in Jesus all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Father, as we give you thanks this morning, as we glorify your name, we lift you on high one more time, oh God, for you are good, you are great, you are wonderful. You are able to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves, oh God. And for that we are grateful, we are thankful. For the many years you have given unto us, even today as we pay memory, Lord, and respect, oh God, to a great man that was with us and worked long and hard and has been taken, oh blessed Father. We bless you for his name. You continue this work, oh God, for the committee, oh blessed Father. And we ask you, oh God, as from year to year and from time to time as we commemorate, we bless you for San Fernando right now. Bless our nation, Trinidad and Tobago. Bless all the works of the government. Bless our opposition. Bless, oh God, we pray thee, because, Lord, we know your blessing is sure. As your word declare, ask and we shall receive, seek and we shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened. I bring the program before you at this time. And I ask, Lord, your peace, your love, your unity on the program as we continue in the name of Jesus. I thank you, God, as the word declare, that every creed and race have an equal place. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Amen, amen, and amen.
Thank you, Bishop. And representing the Anglican Church, we have Father Wayne Moore.
Your greetings on behalf of the Bishop of Trinidad and Tobago, the Right Reverend Claude Berkeley. Let us pray. In our church, we celebrate today the Feast of the Holy Trinity, and we bring before our reflection and our minds with thankfulness God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, three persons in one God. And we celebrate the creation through the Father, and we recognize in the person of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ his work, his teaching, and his salvation. And we recognize and we embrace and we thank God for the gift of his Holy Spirit as he continues to move among us, to guide us and to shape our lives and call us into a relationship with him. Dear Heavenly God, we thank you for the continuation of your work in our lives, calling us into your presence and inviting us to share your creation as we respond to the image in which we were created. And so, dear loving God, we thank you for raising up your son, our brother, Dr. Eric Williams. And during his time in which he served this nation with distinction, in which he dedicated his life to his people, and as, dear God, you showed your love and your faithfulness among your people, he too, out of the love of his country, dedicated his life to the service and the building up of this country. We thank you, Lord, and we pray that the legacy which he championed and the gifts which you give us will be an inspiration to us all as we continue to honor what he did for us, and we pledge to follow in the footsteps of the way in which you call us. We pray, God, that your blessings will fall upon this celebration of his 40th, the anniversary of his passing. We pray, God, that you will lift up this country, that you will bless all the peoples of this land, so that we may be an example to others as we walk the journey that you, our God, invite us to. As Jesus says in Revelation chapter 3, behold, I stand before the door and knock, and if anyone should answer, I will come in and eat. And therefore, Lord, on this occasion, we invite you into our presence and ask that you continue to bless our lives and ask that you help us to remember and lift up the example of our first leader, our first prime minister, our first premier, so that we will fulfill the plan that you have for all of us and for this nation. I ask this in the name of our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And last but certainly not least, representing the Hindu faith, Pandit Surendra Maharaj.
In prayer, but you are called by many names, as Jehovah, as Allah, as Krishna, but you are that one creator of the entire universe, from the mountain tops to the valleys. You are that one who have sent forth a little babe, a little child into the world in the year 1911, the 25th of September. That child would have grown to become a premier, to become a chief minister, to become a prime minister. That child would have grown to earn that name as the father of a nation, one who would have given each one of us an identity, would have given us something that we can cherish and we can continue to work towards, to be able to secure the future for the generations that lie ahead. Today, Lord, we know 41 years would have passed, a legend would have moved on from this physical world, but his legacy lives on in the hearts of all of us. We pray that his struggles, his labors would inspire us and inspire generations to come to stand up for equity, to stand up for justice, to stand up to be that one to maintain that patriotism and that love for our nation. We pray, Lord, in our hearts, we give thanks for a great soul, a great being. Isha Vashyam Idam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Taktena Bhunjitaha Ma Kashid Dukabhagavet. O Lord, we pray, as you are that creator, you have assigned everything in this world for our being, for our welfare. Let us know that which is ours. Let us be able to cherish that, and let us know that which is set aside for another. We pray, Lord, to live in a nation side by side, with oneness, with togetherness, eternally. Om Shanti, Om Shanti, Om Shanti. Let there be peace, let there be peace, let there be peace eternally. Sitaram, everyone.
So, gentlemen, I invite you to have your seats. Continue the proceedings this morning. I recognize the President of His Worship in the Air of San Fernando. And on such an important and festive occasion, as we recognize indeed the undisputable father of the nation, we take the opportunity to invite a true daughter of the soil, an upcoming cultural icon, Miss Michelle Dowridge, to join us in song.
Good morning, everyone. And for those who are not from San Fernando, welcome. My song today recognizes that every man, every woman has a dream. But if we don't have people who will take that dream further, then that dream will never be enough. So, Mr. Vidal, I congratulate you for continuing this dream of yours, this honoring of our legacy of the father of our nation. But I want to thank everyone for joining in to carry on the dream. And to hold my breath, let it stay this way. Can't let this moment end.
You set off a dream in me, getting louder now. Can you hear it echoing? Take my hand, will you share this with me? 'Cause darling, without you, all the shine of a thousand spotlights, all the stars we steal from the night sky will never be enough, never be enough. Towers of gold are still too little. These hands can hold the world, but it will never be enough, never be enough. Spotlights, all the stars we steal from the night sky will never be enough, never be enough. Towers of gold are still too little. These hands can hold the wind, but it will never be enough, never be enough for me. From the critic programs, His Worship the Mayor of San Fernando, Junior Regrello, to join us and give some remarks. We could not miss this opportunity.
Studio Williams, Mr. Vidal, the person responsible for this morning's event, members of the Diplomatic Corps, especially invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. In Dr. Williams' biography, he said, some men were born great, others had greatness bestowed on them, and some achieved greatness. He said he was born great, Trinidad style. Greatness was bestowed on him from the cradle. A very bold statement, and very few men can make a statement like that. If you were to ask the average Venezuelan student who the father of the nation in Venezuela, they'll all say Simón Bolívar. And if you go to India and ask a student in India who the father of the nation in India, they'll all say Mahatma Gandhi. Likewise, if you go to the United States, they'll all say George Washington, and the list goes on. But if you ask in Trinidad and Tobago who's the father of the nation, you get a great answer, depending on the demographics and the geography. And this is where we have fell down, in establishing the work and legacy of Dr. Williams. And this is in that context we must appreciate this morning's event. Mr. Vidal, sometimes things take a little bit of It will terrorize you to get things done. But we understand the value of what he's doing in the Pacific. Dr. Williams came to us in 1956. I want us to understand the dynamics of the time and the politics of the time. That was 10 years after the Universal Adult Suffrage Act was declared, where people can now vote. For you to vote before that period, you had to own properties and also speak the Queen's language. So in 1956, people were looking for education, looking for information, and wanted to understand the dynamics of the world as it was. When you consider over 70% of our nation did not attend high school, a limited amount of children were allowed to go to college as a case would. So it is in that scenario, in that perspective, Dr. Williams had a catchment audience and he went about putting his bucket down and educating people. Several meetings were held right in this bandstand here, when he spoke across the troops as far as we could have been to the information education. And this is how we have to understand Dr. Williams' role. He came at a time when we needed him. He took us to different levels of politics and independence, the political empire. And at the same time, he had some challenges because we all sang in the 50s, God Save Our Gracious Queen, which was our national anthem. One must understand that the Western Peninsula was occupied by 10,000 American soldiers. There was an agreement that the Western Peninsula was controlled by the Americans. Dr. Williams had to undo that. He also had a vision to bring the Caribbean together as one. Well. That would very well be the only feeling during his outstanding career as a Prime Minister. Another aspect of him is the amount of books that he wrote during that period. And we all know the terrible and difficult country to govern. And while he went through the dynamics and challenges that he was faced with, he had found time to write several outstanding books that are now used as a reference in libraries all over the world, maybe except in Trinidad and Tobago. We all speak about capitalism to slavery, his outstanding literature. But one that stands out to me and relevant today, I think it was written in 1973, is Race and Nationalism in Trinidad and Tobago. Unfortunately, that book is no longer in print. That book is relevant to us today. I want to congratulate Mr. Vidal on what he's doing here, and we all have a responsibility to ensure that Dr. Williams' legacy lives on. May God continue to bless you, sir. May God continue to bless the people of Trinidad and Tobago, and may we enjoy the blessing.
Please permit me to borrow from the words of His Worship when he made mention of the work of establishing the work and the legacy of Dr. Williams. And that is what we are doing here today because of the work of another gentleman that will speak with us shortly. It is worthy to recognize that this is the first time that this memorial has come to the city of San Fernando in its approximately 20 years of existence. And that is something that I think we should also applaud. Expanding the legacy. And with that, permit me to invite to the microphone Mr. Reginald Vidal. He is the chairman of the Eric Eustace Williams Memorial Committee and the organizer of the activity which we are enjoying this morning. Mr. Vidal.
Greetings to all. Distinguished the mayor of the city of Port of Spain, of San Fernando, His Worship, Mr. Junior Rigrello, distinguished members of the diplomatic corps, I welcome you in a very special way to this ceremony. Colonel Reynold York, commanding officer acting Trinidad and Tobago Cadet Force, members of the Trinidad and Tobago Police Band, who are here this morning in a very special way. When they should be on vacation, they have come to support this event, and they have also come to bid farewell in the next few days or so, I understand, to their Deputy Commissioner of Police, Mrs. Joanne Archie. I want to thank you all for your support for her and for this ceremony this morning. Members of the Trinidad and Tobago Cadet Force, members of the Girl Guides, the Scouts, members of the clergy, recipients of the Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Awards, Mrs. Joan Yule Williams, Deputy Political Leader of the People's National Movement, Mr. Junior Bisnat, our former National Flag Bearer who has come out of retirement after serving this committee for the last 22 years. And this morning you would see him sitting. You would see him sitting. Throughout those last 22 years, he has never sat. You would see him standing throughout the ceremony, unflinching. And this morning you see him sitting. His knees are getting weaker, and he cannot. But he's here this morning with his flag, his national flag, to support this effort. And I want to thank him in a very special way. My friends in the media, my wife, Dr. Maritza Vidal, could not be with us this morning owing to other medical assignments. And my son, Adrian, who came late from Port of Spain, and he stands in front of me with his wife. Thank you for coming, son. Thank you. Distinguished all ladies and gentlemen, today, as we come together to commemorate the 41st anniversary of the passing of the nation's first Chief Minister, Premier, Prime Minister, and Father of the Nation, the late and still great Dr. Eric Eustace Williams. Many of you who have attended this ceremony over the years must be wondering what has caused the ceremony to be held in San Fernando, as this is not where the final rites of Dr. Williams was performed, or where his funeral service, if you wish, was held before he was cremated and his ashes taken out to sea. While I'm very happy to come to San Fernando, I am and will remain very disappointed because permission was not granted to have this ceremony at the heliport Chagaramas, and with no justifiable reason or reasons for the 2021 and 2022 intended ceremonies. So here I am in beautiful San Fernando. I asked the question, could this have taken place anywhere else in the world where a leader the magnitude of Dr. Williams can be given such disrespect, disloyalty, and dishonor? It could not happen in China. It could not happen in India. It could not happen in the United States of America. It could not happen in Britain, in Venezuela, in Panama, and any other country represented by the representatives who are attending this ceremony today. No, it can never happen, but only in our beautiful Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, including my friends who are looking to come around, thank you for coming. Thank you for listening. My country undoubtedly is in a total mess, the likes of which must have Dr. Williams turning in his grave, I am sure. Domestic violence out of control, school children engaging in violent confrontation with lethal weapons, No respect for teachers, parents, senior citizens. School children seem to be at war with the society. And what is being done to stem this tide of violence? What I ask, what can be done? What is being done? The horses have bolted from the stable a long time ago and cannot be located, far less to get them back in the stable. My distinguished ladies and gentlemen, on the eve of independence on the 31st of August 20, 1962, just about 60 years ago, Dr. Williams chose, before anything else, to speak to the children at a rally at the Queen's Park Oval. There were over 20,000 children from all parts of the country. They came to hear the Father of the Nation talk to them and what is going to be expected of them as we begin the journey as a new independent nation. He spoke about respect for your parents and teachers. He spoke about respecting your national flag. He spoke about carrying the future of the nation in your school bags. And I'm going to ask Mr. Reed, the PA man, to play what Dr. Williams said to the children and let this country understand that if they were following what Dr. Williams had said then, the school violence and the problems with the children in this country would not be as how it is today. Mr. Reed.
Our nation of many varied races.
Of the citizens of the independent state of Trinidad and Tobago. And in a few years after that, you will be called upon by the law of the land to share in the privileges and responsibilities, the rights and duties of citizens. Tomorrow, I shall have an equally great honor and responsibility, that of being the first Prime Minister of an independent nation. I am very happy indeed. I am very happy indeed, therefore, to take part today in this memorable rally and to send a message through you, the boys and girls here today at the Queen's Park Oval, to all the young people of Trinidad and Tobago. Our new nation must maintain and develop its political system and its democratic machinery. It must provide the cabinet ministers, the members of parliament, the civil servants, the doctors, the lawyers, the engineers, the ambassadors, the nurses, the teachers, the skilled workers, and the writers and artists which every independent nation has and provides for itself. It must organize and plan our economy to increase the national wealth and improve our living standards. We who are doing all this today, as well as we can, will have to give way in the years to come to you young people who will come forward to take our place. The nation is on the march. There is no turning back. The road from now on leads forward and only forward. Your responsibility, therefore, is a very heavy one. If you shirk it, you betray the nation. If you fail in that responsibility, you jeopardize our nation. I have given to the nation as its watchword, discipline, production, tolerance. They apply as much to you, the young people, as to your parents. The discipline is both individual and national. We must produce in order to enjoy. Wealth does not drop from the sky for any individual or any nation. Your rally here today is a good demonstration of our mixed society. Some of you have ancestors who came from one country, some from another, others from a third. Some of you profess one religion, some another, others a third or fourth. You in your school have, like the nation in general, only two alternatives. You learn to live together in peace, or you fight it out and destroy one another. The second alternative makes no sense and is sheer barbarism. The first alternative is civilized and is simple common sense. You, the children, yours is a great responsibility to educate your parents. Teach them to live together in harmony. The difference between not race or color of skin, but merit only. Differences of wealth and family status being rejected in favor of equality of opportunity. I call upon all of you young people to practice what you bring today and tomorrow, to translate the ideal of our national anthem into a code of everyday behavior, and to make our nation one in which every creed and race find an equal place. I give you the young people one additional principle on which to base your life for the salvation of our nation. This principle is honesty. In your future career, you will at some time or other have responsibility for money that is not yours. Whether your employer is the government of the country or a private firm, every country makes special provision for the control of public expenditure and for the protection of the property of its citizens. In the final analysis, however, the control is exercised not by the government or by the police, but by the citizens themselves. Make honesty the guiding principle of your life from this day forward. Let your ambition be the development of a nation which, whatever its limitations, is distinguished in the eyes of the world by the honesty and the integrity of its citizens. And so I say to you young people, forward to independence. Do not allow anyone to disrespect our national flag. Do not allow anyone to destroy one single national flag. Do not allow anyone to desecrate our national anthem. They are your flag, your God, your anthem. It is your nation, even more than it is the nation of your parents. You are the future. We are at best the present, at worst the past. In your tender and loving hands, the future of the nation is entrusted. In your innocent heart, the pride of the nation is enshrined. On your collective development, the salvation of the nation is dependent. When you return to your classes after independence, remember therefore, each and every one of you, that you carry the future of Trinidad and Tobago in your school bag. Good luck to you all, to your parents and your teachers. and to Trinidad and Tobago.
Dr. Williams implored them to be honest citizens. He spoke to them like a father speaking to his children. What do you see today? Everything that Dr. Williams asked to be followed has turned to zero, to zilch. And everyone is running like headless fowls, trying to recover the damage that is irreparable by looking towards finding solutions that are not easily attainable. You see, this country has tried to bury the legacy of Dr. Williams. Oxford University, after 81 years, has recognized capitalism and slavery and its relevance to today's economic development in third world societies. And what is ironic is that after 41 years, Dr. Williams is forgotten by his own countrymen. There's testimony of that today. It's that today. Not me, it's the country. What a shame. And school children are suffering today because throughout the years, no one saw it necessary to remind them of what Dr. Williams expected of them. In my own very small way, I have presented to many schools a portrait picture of Dr. Williams and the same CD of his speech he gave. And when that was exhausted, beg as I may, I could not get any sponsor to provide additional portraits and CDs to give to schools. Today, I want to congratulate Trinity College East and the Lakshmi Girls High School. They received portraits of Dr. Williams and CDs. And I think of today, there might be the portrait in Trinity College still up, and that was given about 15 or 16 years ago. And I think it's still up at the Lakshmi Girls High School in St. Augustine. Ladies and gentlemen, today, I don't think that Dr. Williams would have been happy to know the children are being suspended and expelled from schools. It is not what he would have wanted. I say today, fix the situation now and save our nation's children before it's much too late. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, today, I want to thank all members of the medical fraternity, doctors, nurses, wardsmaids, ambulance drivers, all those who have given yeoman service and have seen us through the COVID-19 pandemic quite successfully, that what was displayed in what Dr. Williams would have expected. He expected a disciplined professional approach, and that was very evident. He wanted a productive approach by medical professionals, and he got it. He wanted a tolerant approach and he got it. It was the legacy of discipline, production and tolerance that he left us. It was what has taken us to where we are today. That great man had the kind of foresight that is the envy of so many, and that might be why his legacy and memory is forgotten. My distinguished friends, this country and those who should know better have caused such irreparable damage to this country by treating the legacy and memory with the utmost disrespect, dishonor, and disdain. That is how this nation, the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, has treated the father of the nation. And today is a historic day in San Fernando. And your worship, the mayor of San Fernando, I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to come here to remember the legacy and memory of the father of the nation. I thank you so much, your worship, for that. I want to ask His Worship. Your Worship, can I ask you to join hands with all the churches, NGOs, and other groups in the name of Dr. Eric Williams and make your city and the country a safe, happy, and enjoyable place where all brethren can live in harmony with one another, so that together we aspire, together all we will achieve. I ask you. Your Worship, it was an honor and a pleasure to return to the city of San Fernando, and I'm very happy to see this memorial site very much intact. I thank you. I remember when I was here on the 25th of September 2016 to unveil this memorial, many had it to say that I wanted everything to be named after Dr. Williams in Trinidad and Tobago. Yes, I would like to have every named street, everything named after Dr. Williams, in that the country would be a better place. And some said the memorial would be desecrated and people would destroy it. It is as beautiful as when I left it in 2016, very much intact. And this is why I am able to come back here and present this ceremony at this memorial. Your Worship, I continue to ask you to look over it and ensure that it is not desecrated. Because I got this built by the Belgrove Group of Companies. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I have come what I think is to the end, but I am still being asked by Colonel York not to come to the end of this presentation of this ceremony. In other words, this could very well be my last speech that I will be giving in San Fernando. I retired from my former job in San Fernando, and ironically, it could very well be that I'm retiring from this event today. Colonel York, your request of me is highly be considered, but the time comes when you have to go, but I would consider it. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, well, I just said the last speech. I want to thank all those who have supported me throughout the last 40 of the 41 years of Dr. Williams passing. And I would like to make a final appeal to those in authority that for the sake of the children, could you set aside a Remembrance Day to be referred as Dr. Eric Eustace Williams Remembrance Day for the sake of the children of our beautiful nation, which is slowly being destroyed. I would also like to ask and make a special plea, a special request to you, Mrs. Chatur, who is representing the Catholic Church today. It's an unusual request, but I make it none the same. Can you ask His Grace the Archbishop if there's a day in the Catholic calendar of the Church that can be shared in keeping the memory of Dr. Eric Eustace Williams alive? Because I think that is where the only hope of having him remembered. And I ask you kindly to make that request of Archbishop for me, please, so that one of his days can be in part referred to as Dr. Eric Williams Remembrance Day. So my dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all so much. May God continue to bless you all. And I thank you, and may God bless our nation. Thank you so much.
From Mr. Vidal after a period of service, as we come to recognize a very rich legacy. Just prior to our future address of the day, having heard so many rich addresses and rich invocations, we now would like to invite the rich voices. So we invite for a song, Voirish. Thank you.
So cut us, make we feel our way. So cut us, make we feel our way. So cut us, make we feel. So cut us, make we feel. She has style, one of a kind, yeah. Make every breed and race come together and congregate, oh. And woman, boy, and girl, she capturing every age, oh. But she have a natural beauty. Need to do your civic duty. We need to protect all of our love. Trinidad, I love you so. Just as sweet
to you. Go.
Tobago, I really love you.
Go.
If you're feeling the heat, stop and drink a coconut water.
Up on Maracas Beach,
under umbrella with your cooler.
What you're feeling to eat,
bake a chop from Richard, no other. And if anything later, we could take a spin down the avenue. Go look some pretty girl with the rude boy crew. Caribbean man, Caribbean your hand too. License no wine and jam, and anything I pass through. Not a nation sweet as you. Trinidad, I love you so.
Can't let you go.
Trinidad, I love you so.
Can't let you go.
This is not just as sweet.
Can't let you go.
Tobago, I really love you.
Can't let you go.
Tobago.
I
appreciate you.
One of a kind.
With my lady out in the Highland pool. Don't talk when it's harvest time and they giving me food. I just want to watch them caress and laugh. Later me knows how some more postcard. Can't miss great feto. Just to make it a perfect harmony. The Trinidad's perfect melody. And it sounds so sweet to me. Trinidad, I love you so. Trinidad, I love you so. Your sister just as sweet too. Tobago, I really love you.
Trinidad, I love you so.
Trinidad, I love you so. Your sister just as sweet too. Tobago, I really love you. She have vibes, full up of vibes.
She have style,
one of a kind, yeah.
When the music is that sweet, the breeze, even the wind starts to blow at the end of the performance. I do want to say though that I always found it very interesting that this song and these particular sisters are the only two sisters that someone could say, I love you so, your sister just as sweet too. Try it any other time, I dare you. We continue with the Fitia address by Dr. Noel Ocho. He is the director of the Faculty of Medicine at my alma mater, the University of the West Indies. Dr. Ocho.
Thank you so much, our Master of Ceremonies, to my distinguished friend, Pastor Clarendon, the Mayor of San Fernando, Mr. Ricardo, former Member of Parliament, Mrs. Joan Yoon Williams, members of the Diplomatic Corps, Mr. Reginald Vidal, himself, the members of the religious fraternity, to the protective services and the music band, to the media, to the participants, well-wishers. Today I feel extremely honored and privileged to serve as the keynote speaker at the 41st Reed Lane ceremony to commemorate the life and legacy of our first Premier and Prime Minister. As I considered this responsibility that has been placed upon me, I find myself feeling extremely honored, yes, yet modestly proud, to posit a dialogue that is intended to cause reflection, re-evaluation, and refocus of the concept of legacy in general, and the legacy of Dr. Williams in particular. I could remember the morning when the news broke on March 29th, 1981. I was just walking out of the yard when I overheard the neighbors calling out to one another, indicating that the Doc, as he was fondly called, had passed away. I could still feel the mood and the atmosphere around me. The skyline was gray and somber, as if the very elements of nature had coalesced to join with the nation to mourn the demise of one of its greatest sons. This feeling was palpable, and there was an air of concern and uncertainty as to whom would become the successor of a proverbial maximum leader whose profile, though short, stood tall with academic and scholastic achievements. He was respected globally, and his understanding of his social and the political contexts were unparalleled. You see, whether we like it or not, each one of us is involved in planting seeds that will eventually be harvested, which will result in the type of legacy that we leave when we demit public office or retire from a job or eventually leave this earth. Being reminded of death is actually a good thing, because death informs life. It gives us a perspective on what's important. But legacy is really about life and living. It helps us to decide the kind of life we want to live and the kind of world we want to live in. One of my professors at the University of Washington, Patrick Doble, in an article, Ethical Leadership and the Ethical Importance of Legacy, he argued, when people depart, the consequences of their actions upon people and the physical and social world endure as their legacy. He went on to say that the thought of leaving a legacy connects meaning by insisting that the consequences of what we do matters and should be taken seriously. When individuals cease to exist physically, he continues, their actions will still affect people, institutions, and the environment. He ended this by saying, recognizing that all individuals leave a legacy buttresses responsibility by insisting that each human contributes. You see, inherent in this argument is a posture that each person who has been placed in a position of authority, whether elected into political office, whether the level of standing on the social landscape, or even at the individual level, we all have a responsibility to ensure that our actions are consistent, responsible, but at the same time sensitive that there is some level of accountability that is juxtaposed to that social position. This brings me to a critical foundational principle that will form the basis of my argument on the subject at hand. And it says, legacy is lived and lives on after death. You see, Rashid Oganluru said, legacy is not something that's what's left for tomorrow when you're gone. It is what you give, create, impact, and contribute today while you're here that happens to live on. But I love what Peter Strupple said. He said, legacy is not leaving something for people. It is leaving something in people. Permit me then to focus on a few areas that to my mind resonates with me as I reflect on Dr. Williams and his legacy. Because I've been asked to speak to is the legacy of Dr. Eric Williams still relevant for Trinidad and Tobago? The first point I'd like to make, and I'm looking at it through the lens, what I consider the lessons we have learned from Dr. Williams. Dr. Williams has taught us the importance of building resilient institutions. In 1956, Dr. Williams established the political party called the People's National Movement. It is interesting to note that this movement was birthed out of an insatiable appetite for national determinism and an aversion to colonial and neocolonial domination. Britannica says, and I quote, Williams became associated with the Caribbean Commission that was established by the United States, Great Britain, France, and the Netherlands in an effort to coordinate the economic development of the Caribbean area. They went on to say that his aggressive commanding role in the commission, however, tended to alienate the national powers, especially the US, and in 1955 to 56, he organized the PNN, which won the general election. You see, the importance of symbolism in creating this political identity was also important. The balise or heliconia is its symbol. It is easy to care for, thrives in full sun, and resilient under pressure. It is amazing that building such an institution, it has been able to withstand political changes for 33 in 1986, 1818 in 2001, and 2912 in 2010, which then was disparagingly called the maxi-taxi. But like the balise flower, successive generations of leadership under Mr. Patrick Manning in 1986 and 2001, as well as Dr. Keith Christopher Rowley in 2010, have been able to demonstrate the political survivability of the institution called the PNN. You see, one could argue that he was a maximum leader. And if you read Rafik Shah's piece of January 1914, entitled, I Came Not to Praise Carl, he posits that sense of maximum leadership. However, one could argue that while he may have been a maximum leader, there is also a corollary that should be considered. You see, any institution that is young needs strong leadership who could provide strategic direction and must be able to develop rules of engagement to ensure survivability. I am unsure, but maybe this could be the reason why the PNM as an institution, which was started by Dr. Williams, has such a political legacy and has been able to withstand the many metamorphoses of the opposition, like DLP, ULF, Club 88 NAR, and the current UNC. The second point, Dr. Williams has taught us the importance of social justice and social accountability in governance. I refer to his inaugural speech on Independence Day, 1962, when he said, and I quote, "Democracy means more, much more than the right to vote and one vote for every man and every woman for the prescribed age. Democracy means recognition of the rights of others. Democracy means equality of opportunity for all in education, in the public service, and in the private employment." I repeat, he said, "and in private employment, democracy means the protection of the weak against the strong." You see, inherent in this philosophical position was an understanding and recognition of the role of the state in ensuring that every citizen has a right to freedom, whatever that is constituted to be. While there is a commensurate level of responsibility that must be aligned to such rights, it is this sense of social accountability that was pervasive in national policy, whether the right to education, right to health, right to freedom of free speech, right to association as constitutionally protected. It is a social justice agenda that allowed persons like me, coming from a single parent home of 15 children, the first as the 12th of those 15 children to write common entrance and the first to attend secondary school. It is that social justice agenda that allowed many of us to have access to healthy meals, that moved from milk biscuits in the 60s and a cup of milk to a fulsome breakfast and lunch. The third point is that Dr. Williams has taught us the difference between political language as theater as opposed to political language as philosophy. Political leadership requires the capacity to not only influence change, but be authentic while being contextually relevant. For many politicians, their capacity to build alliances necessitates an understanding of the vulnerabilities of their respective communities, which often allows them to use language that will facilitate knee-jerk reactions and political cronyism. This contributes then to a situation where there is inciting of the masses through the use of political language that is expedient rather than intelligent debate that is rooted in a philosophical framework. I reflect on two political leaders who have both served as prime ministers in this country. One said, "Politics has a morality of its own." While this is a truism, there's a subliminal message that is intricately linked to this statement, which suggests that politics has its own morality. There is no inherent wrong in what is done as long as it is politically expedient. On the other hand, I've heard another prime minister say, in relation to a minister in a government. It may not be ethical, but it's not illegal. Again, there is a representation of the politics of oratory theater to facilitate the spin of words, as well as a demand for less accountability in public affairs. On the other hand, I reflect on some statements made by Dr. Williams. The first was made at the Independence Day rally that Mr. Fidal referred to. As he spoke to our children, he said, and I quote, "On your scholastic development, the salvation of the nation is dependent. You carry the future of Trinidad and Tobago in your book bags." The second statement was even more philosophical in determining the way forward for the Federation of the West Indies at a time when Jamaica decided to withdraw, when he said, "One from ten leaves note." While this was mathematically incorrect, the philosophical underpinning of the statement was so profound that to this day, CARICOM is yet to really function as a well-oiled machinery. However, upon these fundamentally philosophical statements lie a trajectory that forces us to revisit political language as an extension of one's legacy. It is clear to me that Dr. Williams' language lacked political theater, but engaged people at the intellectual, but also affective domain in a context that was unambiguous. The fourth thing which I wish to speak to is Dr. Williams has taught us the importance of personal and social identity. In a very telling narrative in solidifying the identity of Trinbagonians, Dr. Williams stated quite eloquently in the history of Trinidad and Tobago, and I quote, "There can be no Mother India for those whose ancestors came from India. There can be no Mother Africa for those of African origin. There can be no Mother England and no dual loyalties. There can be no Mother China. Even if one agrees as to which China is the mother, and there can be no Mother Syria and no Mother Lebanon. A nation like an individual can only have one mother. The only mother we recognize is Mother Trinidad and Tobago, and mother cannot discriminate between her children." While we all have recognized the value of developing and maintaining a national identity, this appears to be more utopian than reality. As nationals, we do not have a national dress, for dress is ethnically defined. We do not have a national dish, for it has to be aligned to ethnicity. Nor do we have a national instrument, for various sectors of the society continue to fight for ethnic representation of national instruments. Maybe Dr. Williams' dream in this regard may be just an impossible dream. And the final thing I want to posit is that Dr. Williams has taught us the importance of political self-determination. In his inaugural Independence Day address of August 31st, 1962, he said, and I quote, "You are now a member of the Commonwealth's family in your own right, equal in status to any of its members. You hope soon to be a member of the world family of nations, playing your part, however insignificant in world affairs. You are on your own in a big world. in which you are one of the many nations, some small, some medium-sized, some large. You are nobody's boss, and nobody is your boss. End of quote. While there was no potential economic boom on the horizon, there was an inherent understanding that to remain subservient to the monarchy was an indication of a willingness to remain in a position of subservience. We know too well the example of our Haitian counterparts who, in their quest for political liberation, has to contend with an enormous economic bill that to this day is like an albatross around their necks. You see, understanding this philosophical position allowed us as a young nation to receive independence in 1962 and 14 years later, Republican status in 1976. I could not help but reflect on what would have been his thinking when a mere 3 years ago there were political machinations by persons who sit in our current parliament of Trinidad and Tobago who were intent on calling for sanctions to be brought against the government of Trinidad and Tobago in dealing with the humanitarian crisis experienced by Venezuelans. It was a political institution of stature that he founded that allowed the party in power, which is still aligned to his philosophy, to stand against the tyranny of the mighty USA in spite of the USA attempts to bait fellow Caribbean counterparts to align themselves with an ideology that was inimical to the right to self-determination and assuming a national posture in a global context. As I conclude then, I wish to posit, ladies and gentlemen, that I've tried to present some material facts as I see it. My thoughts have not been exhaustive, however. In an attempt to deal with the substantive issue at hand, captioned, "Is the legacy of Dr. Williams still relevant for Trinidad and Tobago?" I believe that I've made a comprehensive case. Understanding that legacy is not something that is left for, but in people, I have no doubt. In the global socio-economic climate and the continued fragmentation of our society, his legacy is even more relevant today. Our current political environment does not require theater, but a resolute commitment to country rather than ethnic solidarity. It requires the building of bridges upon which we all could cross, rather than building skyscrapers upon which only a few could ascend. His legacy must not be diminished, nor should our children continue to grow in a society where Dr. Williams is just another name, or a name that is relegated to the dustbin of history. We owe it to ourselves, since he has left Mother Trinidad and Tobago in and for us. I thank you.
For a bit of levity, we invite once more the rich voices to join us one last time in song.
I've Warish again, and this is our second and final performance today, and we are going to sing a cappella again. It was not planned that way, but we know that as proud South people, we will join in with us and we will get the vibe of the song. So we hope you enjoy.
Thank you. a border fella from south. He always swanky, nobody as swanky as he. Corey Fraser is the character, the iron beater from Metal Steel Orchestra. When he jam in iron, it's real confusion. He's the healthiest, grooviest, swankiest, sweetest iron beater in the land. Talking about Iron Man, Corey's sweeter than honey when the man jam iron. Woman does leave the man. Iron Man, Corey's sweeter than honey licking ting. He jam in, the woman trembling. Iron Man, Corey's sweeter than honey pitting. Pitting, 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 pitting. Pitting, pitting, pitting. Pitting, pitting, pitting. Bring the iron up, I bring it, 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 bring the iron up, I bring it, 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 bring the iron up. Hold it, make some noise, jump around and make some noise. Hold it, hold it, make some noise, jump around and make some noise. Nothing sweeter than hearing the sound of all iron beating. Pling, 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 pling. Tell me where the Iron Man,
where the Iron Man,
listen from the band,
listen from the band.
Pling, 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 pling. When the music fills you up,
leave the stress of a lonely, let me take on your journey.
Music brings the love,
throw away all my burdens, leave all that is hurting.
I bring it, 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 bring me iron love. I bring it, 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 bring me iron love. Hold it, make some noise, jump around and make some noise. Hold it, hold it, make some noise, jump around and make some noise. Iron Man, oh, he's sweeter than honey lick the pan, jam iron. Woman has leave the man, Iron Man, oh he's sweeter than honey lick the pan, jam iron. Woman has leave the man, is loving the iron, iron, iron beating the iron, iron, iron beating the iron, iron, iron jamming to iron, iron, is loving the iron, iron, iron beating the iron, iron, iron beating the iron, iron, iron jamming to iron. Iron Man, only sweeter than honey when the man jump iron. Woman has leave the man. Iron Man, only sweeter than honey licking ting. He jump in. Iron of the life, yeah. Everybody nice, yeah. Come and join the line. Leave all that is hurting. Iron Man, bring me iron love.
Thank you very much.
We will now move into the wreath laying ceremony led by Mr. Vidal of the Eric Williams Memorial Committee, and I invite our colleagues from the Bill Guides Association to assist us in the laying of the wreath. Thank you. As you can see, there are some showers of blessings. Please enter to have your seats. Showers of blessings in our proceedings as we now move into the presentation of the awards. I invite Mr. Vidal to join us. Mrs. Diane Dupre, and she will be receiving the Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for her outstanding contribution in the sphere of steel band movement, community, and public service.
Receiving on her behalf.
And it will be received by a representative on her behalf, Ms. Deborah Ishmael. Up next, Miss Angela Nesbitt, Girl Guides as Administrator, receiving the Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for her outstanding contribution in the sphere of youth development, community, and public service. Daniel Austin, not present. Mr. Austin is currently in quarantine. However, he is the marketing manager of Extra Food Supermarket Limited, and he will be bestowed with Father the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for his outstanding contribution in the sphere of business, community, and public service. I take great pride in calling the next name, Major Retired Sylvester Ford. Retired from Trinidad and Tobago Cadet Force and Public Service of Trinidad and Tobago. He will receive the Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for his outstanding contribution in the spheres of youth development, community, and public service.
I feel I'm on the, I'm still shooting now, I can't talk now, I'm still recording.
Also in quarantine is Mr. Joseph Mendoza, who will be receiving the Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for his outstanding contribution in the sphere of community and public service. Please give him a round of applause. And finally, Mrs. Merle Ambedigans, retired executive assistant, Scouts Association of Trinidad and Tobago. She will receive the Father of the Nation Honor Bronze for her outstanding contribution in the sphere of child development, community, and public service.
We have done well to use the discussion of this culture. All these are the things which have been documented as part of the and we have done that. Pleasing to the name and legacy of the world. And I take the pride of the gentleman.
And to close off our ceremony, in the spirit of blessings of great words, showers of blessings, and blessings of music in a cappella fashion, I invite Miss Michelle Dowridge once more to bring some music for us. Please have your seat. Some more music for us in a cappella fashion. And Michaelis. Mrs. Dowridge.
So for those of you who are not too familiar, San Fernando has a song. So it's called, we have no mic, the San Fernando song. So on request of Mr. Vidal, and also as part of the hospitality of San Fernando, I render to you the San Fernando song.
To Mr. Joseph Cipriani, Father of the Nation Medal of Honor Silver for his outstanding contribution in the sphere of the credit union movement at Teachers Credit Union, Community and Public Services.
Fisher, ready one mic.
This is a very important thing in the San Fernando. Bring him in.
Hello.
It's still going on.
What's still going on? Oh, yeah. Okay.
No, no.
Can all the awardees come up, please? Can all the awardees, Mrs. Cipriani, please stay? All the awardees.
This is our own home all the day long. This is our city. This is our song.
San Fernando,
we'll live on. Look to the west, friends, and see the tide. The sea makes a feat with noble pride. Look to the east, friends, with the rambling hills, from whence comes the breeze which has her soul to fill. This is our city. This is our song. Feel free to join in. This is our own home all the day long. This is our city. This is our song. San Fernando, we live on. At the heart of our city, we see her face. Anaparima, that sacred place. Her head still high, yet scarred and bruised. Anaparima will still be true to you. This is our city, this is our song. This is our own home, all the day long. This is our city, this is our song. San Fernando, we live on. Look at our people and their way of life. They struggle hard with standards high. In the nation, we're first in many a way. And the nation's hopes in her are real today. This is our city, this is our song. This is our own home all the day long. This is our city, this is our song. San Fernando, we'll live on. San Fernando, we'll live on.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we close our proceedings, on behalf of the Eric Williams Memorial Committee, I'd like to thank you all for being here. Refreshments will be provided at the auditorium at City Hall. As the music plays from the police band, please join us for a few refreshments.
At City Hall, the auditorium. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.